I'll start with our first interaction ever with MCFD. That was in around 2010 when we became foster parents to Christopher, who was in grade 10 at the time. And I didn't want to be a foster parent. I just felt like taking a foster kid in was putting your own kids at risk. And I thought, I don't want to take that chance. My kids were very healthy, very social, and the last thing I wanted was to put them at unnecessary risk for being, you know, treated poorly by some kid who has been treated poorly themselves. And I met Chris, and I changed my mind after meeting him, especially after hearing his story about his parents, being drug addicts and leaving him in grade 7 and stuff like that. But I could tell that he had a good foundation, good base. So we built a fourth bedroom and he moved in with us. He could have lived on his own, but he moved in with us. And it was the best decision we ever made. He was a great role model for my children. He still is a part of our lives. He's getting married. He has a child of his own. He's in his 20s now. Works for a company in Port Kells. He's a heavy-duty mechanic, you know, so he's one of the success stories. I like to feel like we played a small role in that. I think he's responsible for getting himself where he is, more so than us. But the experience with MCFD was very, very, I would say, non-existent, actually, because we never saw them. We never saw the social worker. I never heard from the social worker. I think Nick's mom heard from the social worker just through emails or text, but she never came to our house. Never had a criminal record check done, never inspected the house to see if I actually had built a bedroom for Chris, because he had to have his own bedroom. Just not there. And some of the things I'd hear Chris say about his interactions seemed just really bizarre, like almost like he was being dismissed, you know. And now I can see why. It's because he was getting close to aging out. They were probably just, okay, he's in a good home, let's forget about him for a while and let's focus on these other kids over here, right? So, but I remember saying to Nick's mom specifically, and her and I have chatted about this before, I never want MCFD ever getting their hooks into my child. They just seem very incompetent. Perhaps the staff are overwhelmed, I don't know, but they just seem like if your kid got into that system, you'd probably never see them again. So our next interaction with them was when we went looking for help for Nick. And that was January of 2015. By then, his marijuana use had escalated into meth. We knew it had. He had stopped coming to my house because I would check his bags and his pockets for drug paraphernalia. And if I found any, I threw it out, broke it, whatever. And so he went to his mom's, and I told her, I said, he's using more than weed and we got to get him help. So she made an appointment with Ministry of Children and Families, which is where she was told to go, and we had a conference call. She went to the office, the social worker and her called me at work, and we had basically a discussion about what options are out there. And the end result of that was nothing. There's nothing out there, nothing immediate, nothing that would get him help right away. It was sort of like, well, we might be able to do this and we might be able to do that. And I started exploring private programs. And I contacted the Métis Nation health person and I said, is there any chance that Métis Nation can help us put our kid in treatment? And the cheapest treatment I could find was $10,000 a month up in Kelowna. And I remember them phoning me and having a chat, and they sounded like a great program, but the fact was is we just didn't have $10,000 a month to put them in that program. And there was no help out there financially to get him in that program either. So he went without, and he got deeper and deeper and deeper into his addiction until he finally assaulted his mom on March 31st, 2015, held a machete to her throat after she took his phone away when he was high on meth. As a consequence, basically, for something he had done. And he thought if he pushed her to the limit, she would cave and give it back, but she didn't. And she managed to get away, and she called 911, and the police came, and they arrested him. And they didn't want to put him in jail overnight. So they asked if they could bring him to my house, and I said, sure, as long as he follows two rules. That's it. Only two rules I ever had were no drugs and be respectful. That's all I want. Don't talk trash to me, and don't bring drugs into my house. And he agreed to respect those rules. And he came home, and we had a heart-to-heart that night, I remember. We had a really good chat and about trying to change the course of his life in a more positive way. And I think he started to feel extremely remorseful for what he did. So I went to bed that night feeling pretty good. And then I got a call at 3 in the morning, and it was the RCMP saying, do you know where your son is? And I said, well, he was in bed when I went to bed. Why? And they said, we have him at Chilliwack General Hospital in the quiet room because he threatened to commit suicide, and a friend saw it and was concerned and called the police. So we found him, and just so you know, we almost shot him because he had a machete in his pants, the same machete he had held against his mom's throat the night before. And he went to go grab it, and they drew their weapons. They didn't shoot him, thank God. And they, you know, tried to get him help. He got assessed by a doctor. And then after that, he was taken to RCMP cells until he appeared in court later that day. And he had a couple of, so he had the assault on his mom, and then the concealed weapon that resulted from when he made the Facebook threat. And I saw him in court for the first time. So that was the first time I saw him with all those layers of clothes on. It was just skin and bones. Like in 3 months, he had gone from a healthy looking kid who was dabbling in meth to a very sick looking child who had to hold his pants up, and his rib cage was sticking out, and his shirt was hanging off of him. And it was a pretty surreal sight when I got there. So he was released on a bunch of conditions to me, and I met with the probation officer and the court-appointed lawyer. And the first thing I told them was, he's Métis, and that needs to be noted in this file, because that triggers a number of things that are supposed to happen in court. There's supposed to be what's called an Aboriginal social history done. There's a social history done, should be a social history done anyway, but when it's an Aboriginal social history, there are some unique things they need to look at, like residential school history or 60s scoop or some stuff like that. But even beyond that, how important is culture in Nick's life? You know, those types of things are examined. And although Nick was not a product of 60s scoop or has that in his family, or at least not in the last couple generations, there was some residential school way back, I suspect, but nothing like 60s scoop more recent. But there are other factors at play with his culture that needed to be explored, like his attachment to elders and things like that. So that got missed. They just sort of got swept aside, even right on the first day of court. The one thing that I remember standing out is when I said to the probation officer is, I just need to get him into a program. How do we get him into a program? And his answer was, he needs to plead guilty if he wants to get into a program. And I was like, okay, I guess that's how it works with the programs that are out there in this province, is you don't get access to them unless you agree to go on probation. So as long as he wasn't incarcerated, I was not too fearful of that. I thought, okay, BC Corrections does have some good programs out there, you know, we'll take a look at it. And so we went and met with the probation officer at his office, and his office was in the Ministry of Children and Families building, so I couldn't figure out why. I just thought they had shared office space, so I was like, okay. So I met with the probation officer, again brought up the culture issue with him, showed him Nick's status card, or his citizenship card from Métis Nation of BC. They copied it, put it on his file. Then I went away downstairs after he gave me his business card, and that's when I realized that he worked for Ministry of Children and Families, not BC Corrections. So I found that really bizarre, because they have such a poor track record with keeping foster kids alive, kids in care alive, why they would also be in charge of youth justice, which is often kids who are one step beyond foster care. A lot of times these are kids who are in foster care, who are now getting in trouble with the law, who are now running away from foster homes and things like that. So I don't know why you would have that same agency involved, but regardless, he pled guilty 3 weeks later. The judge imposed a number of conditions on him, like about 14 or 15, I think. And we started looking for help for him. In the first 2 months of his probation, he had one substance abuse counseling appointment. And he missed it because it was early in the morning. So he slept in and missed it. And we couldn't get in again for another several weeks. That's how limited the resources are out there. I think what happened next was, well, I kept pestering the probation officer over and over and over again for, you know, when's he going to get help? When's he going to get help? And finally, they put him in this program in Campbell River. And the program in Campbell River, we never really named the agency because we don't really blame them. So we don't want them getting sort of any heat for Nick's situation, because I think they really cared about Nick and they cared about his culture. So we've gone out of our way not to name them. But they were really not told Nick's full story. And they took a person into their program that probably shouldn't have been in the program. He wasn't the right fit. Nick had the self-harm history. Although it was minor, it was still there. It was cutting, basically, in grade 7. But he also had the suicide threat from April 1st, 2015. And then coupled with that, he was Aboriginal, which elevated his risk for suicide as well. And the Saturday before the program, he relapsed into meth. So the program staff knew he had relapsed, but what they didn't know was the fact that Nick had a self-harm and suicide history and a recent suicide threat. That apparently did not get shared with them. It was in Nick's medical history. I had filled out his medical history, but the probation officer either shredded it or just disposed of it somehow and never gave it to them. So they took a child into their program that had a recent relapse, who had this history, and they had said, had they known that he had the suicide threat and the self-harm history plus the relapse, they would never have taken him. He would have been considered too high risk at that point, and they would have insisted that he do a medical detox first. So he was essentially detoxing while he was there. And, 6 days after he got there, he stuck his head through Shoelace and twisted himself up and died in a closet alone. And I'll never forgive myself for letting him go to that program, you know. The sad part was that I put him in that probation officer's vehicle. Like, I wanted to take him myself and they wouldn't let me. Like, I'd see he was anxious. And so when Nick went to go leave, he was being kind of passive aggressive. And I said, Nick, you have to go. It's a condition of your probation. And, you know, once you're going to be there, you'll be home before Christmas, right? And grandma will come see you and my sister will come see you. But then we were told we were not allowed to have contact with him the first 5 days he was in the program, at least. He died on the 6th day. And his mom was trying to phone him when the caregivers were on the phone to 911. So I don't understand why they do that. I don't understand why they make rules like that where your child's, you know, gets taken out of the home and put somewhere and you're not allowed to talk to them. I can understand the theory behind it, but in practice it makes no sense at all when the child's so attached to the parents, for starters, and it's so traumatic for him to have been taken. I could put myself in his shoes and I totally can see, because he was a mini version of me, and if I had been taken from my parents' house, I would have been devastated, you know. I did live away from home when I was in my teens, but that was by choice. That wasn't that I ran away. I was doing sports, right? But that was by choice, and I had contact when I wanted contact. And in this case, we weren't allowed to, we were given bad information for starters. It wasn't actually true about the program. We could have had contact, but they were playing games for some reason. The probation officer was playing games. I think he was trying to draw a wedge between his mom and I, and he was trying to play us off against each other, you know, in the hopes that I would stop bugging him. I think what he was looking at was I was just a pest. And so if he could get Nick into the program out of Chilliwack, I wouldn't be able to bug him anymore because he'd be on somebody else's caseload. And then when he comes back at the end of the program, I think he probably would have gone and lived with his mom, maybe full-time or part-time, even though she was the victim of the crime. And then in the hopes that she would be less of a pest to him than me. But yeah, the biggest thing was, well, there were many big things, but one of the biggest things was, to this day, MCFD has never formally told me that my son's dead. They've argued with us about who pays for his body to come home. I'll never forget that. The day after my son died, I'm being told that I have to pay for his body to come home because they don't transport dead bodies, right? And I said to them, I said, you're bringing him home regardless because you're the one who took him there. So you will be paying for him. They finally relented and paid, but I had to argue for every nickel and dime from that agency. You know, we went bare bones on getting him. He was put in a box and driven back to Chilliwack in a hearse. And we followed behind. I paid my own way there and back, you know, on the ferry, as did his mom. But they've never ever sent a formal letter saying, we regret to inform you your son has died, we're very sorry, you know, any of that.
Well, you were saying too that when he passed away, you didn't even know, they hadn't even contacted you.
No, what happened was is the program staff in Campbell River called me, the head person, on June 9th around 5 or 5:30. At night, because I had a couple friends with me, my best friend who's a police officer in Langley, which is a good person to have when you find that kind of news out. And she said, Nick tried to hang himself. And I, in my mind, I was still alive. When someone says he tried, that means he didn't succeed. And she said, I'm going to the hospital right now to see how he is, and I'll call you when I find out. And I didn't hear anything for 45 minutes. And I knew something was wrong. I could feel it in my bones. I could feel there. I wasn't even in my normal state. I was just in this trance-like state while my friends were eating dinner and talking. And I finally said, you know what? I got to call my sister. So I stopped eating and I got up and I left the table and I called my sister and I said, Nick's at the hospital. Can you go check on him? And I told her that he had tried to hang himself. So she called and said, I'm coming up. She's a nurse. She works in community health, and she went up there and then she called me, and as soon as the phone rang I knew, and her first words were, he's gone. And then everything fell apart after that, and my whole world fell apart. You know, I walked around my condo or my townhouse just saying, this isn't supposed to happen. This wasn't supposed to happen like this. I just kept repeating that over and over and over again. And then I just had this instinct to go grab my other son to make sure he was okay. You know, as soon as you lose one child, you think you're going to lose another one. You see how easy it happened to him. And then your life is full of constant anxiety that you're going to lose the other one. So I went and grabbed him from where he was at. And then my boss sent my ex-wife's boss over to my house. She works in the same federal prison system I do. And she's a friend of mine, her boss. So she came over and we waited for the police to do a notification to Nick's mom. But they were doing it for hours and hours, and finally I just said, I can't let her wait anymore. So her boss and I and my best friend and my son all went over to her condo, which was not that far from my place. And my son had a key, so we just let ourselves in. And I just remember she was getting up to get a glass of water or something. And she says, oh, what are you guys doing here? A big smile on her face. Oh, hey, Bobby. And then she saw. And instantly her face dropped. I told her that her son was dead. And our son was dead. And she just collapsed to the floor and screamed. So loud that the neighbors called the police because they thought someone was being raped. And the police showed up in 30 seconds. But I'll never forget that. That memory's burned in my mind forever. I have nightmares about it. I have nightmares about the phone call I got. And I have nightmares about telling his mom. I have nightmares about what his last moments were like. I'll never be the same. You know, a piece of your heart dies. You'll never get it back. And this government, I don't understand them because they just sort of, you know, say, well, children die. That's just the way it is. And it doesn't have to be that way. You know? They just don't understand how devastating it can be for parents. I'll never ever be the same again. I'll just have to live with it the rest of my life. But after he died, we started looking at the youth system and provincial politics, and it made me even more and more angry as I started to look at how long they've known about this issue. They've known about this issue for years. They know they've been underfunding that ministry for years. They know they've been handcuffing social workers for years and cutting programs for years and not investing in children for years. And then all of a sudden, some of us start to get vocal, and in an election year, they start pumping money into the program or into the ministry. It's too late. They had 16 years to kind of get this right, to fix the problem. And they ignored it, and they ignored it, and they ignored it. And then this year, because they want to get reelected, they threw $240 million at Ministry of Children and Families, but no actual planning, no actual investment in programs so kids don't even end up in that ministry in the first place. No investment in public education so kids can get the proper help at school when they're struggling.
You were saying how many children have died each year that we don't even hear about.
Yeah, so Nick was one of four or five cases you might have heard about that year, in 2015. Alex was one, Nick was one, Paige was before next year, Carly was one. She aged out and committed suicide the day after she aged out. So you heard a little bit about those cases, but there was over 100 cases you didn't hear about. And part of me feels kind of, I don't know, not guilty, but just sad that we don't hear about those cases, and it's my case, my son's case, that's being heard about. But if he can be sort of a catalyst for change for the system, I'm good with that. I just want people to understand that there's 100-something Nicks out there, you know, 100-something Alexes out there. And that was 2015. We've now finished 2016, and instead of the system getting better and having fewer deaths, we had more deaths. We had 120, which I think is a new record. So to me, if you're the minister for 4 years and your record of death keeps going up, I think you need to be fired. You need to find a new minister. That's been our focus since Nick died, is trying to make a positive come out of this tragic situation and try and shine a light on the ministry as a whole and on the failings of, because Nick wasn't a foster kid, but that's where most of the deaths happened. Nick was a youth justice case who died. But it's still the same ministry, still the same issues, right? Just cut, 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 nobody's going to say anything. They don't seem to really calculate the return on investment our youth have. Like, if you actually sat and did the math and decided you were going to invest up front in substance abuse and mental health for youth, they don't care about the savings down the road. And the reason they don't, in my opinion, is because they know those kids turn 19 and they become a federal responsibility, not a provincial. So as long as they stay out of my way, you know, throw a little bit of money at them and keep them quiet, but don't give them any real help, because that real help actually costs money. But the return on investment to us as a society is huge. I don't care whether it's federal or provincial, it's still all taxpayer dollars. And it's still our system that's under strain when those kids don't get help and they become addicted and they become, you know, violent. People pay the price, you create more victims down the road, and that costs money as well.
Okay.
So, yeah, before Nick's case, I was just kind of your average BC voter. I would just kind of watch the news and casually observe provincial politics. But I was very focused on federal politics. I was very active in the last federal election on social media and stuff like that, and attending debates and when I could, and looking at how the issues impacted on me and what was important to me. Provincially, I was one of those many voters in the last election that actually changed my vote at the last second and voted Liberal. I was actually seriously going to look at voting NDP last election, and I just kind of panicked in the last couple of days. That I don't remember what it was specifically, but I thought, you know, I think I got played, like many people do. If the economy's good, then everything else will be good too, right? And that's really a smokescreen. The economy has supposedly begun being good for a long time, but yet they've cut and cut. So I got played in the last election, as did a number of people, as did the polls start, you know, the polls were calling for an NDP government. That's not going to happen again. I started looking at the history of MCFD, the history of the Liberals, and the Liberals weren't Liberals. I started to realize they were actually conservative. So they were employing conservative policies, and they're linking investment in public education and investment in Ministry of Children and Families and investment in health, all these things that are really important to us. They started linking it to the economy, and that made me really angry. You know, with Nick, after Nick passed away, the biggest people that supported us were the First Nations people. At his funeral, Grand Chief Stuart Phillip was there. Grand Chief Doug Kelly from First Nations Health Authority contacted us, got a hold of us, and gave us his support as well. The Chief, Harvey Paul from Stehalis, was at his funeral, as were many members of his community. They were the ones that were backing us up in our corner. And Métis Nation of BC, well, though weren't there originally, they are now. They have a new president, and they've been quite active as well in supporting us. And we really appreciate that. You know, Melanie Mark was another one, who's the critic for Ministry of Children and Families. And I know that people try, like the Liberals try to say, that you're making political hay out of children's deaths, and they're not doing it on my child's back, I can tell you that. I know they're not, because when Melanie calls me, she's not calling me to say, oh, I'm going to talk about your son in the legislature today and make a case out of it or whatever. She's calling me to say, hey, how are you doing? Is everything okay? Can I do anything for you? Right? Those types of things. She's not even my MLA, but she still calls me anyway, or contacts me through social media. And I appreciate that. And I feel like she's genuine. I've met her in person since talking to her through social media. And I think she's a genuine person. And she's somebody who I think speaks with authority and authenticity, because she is First Nations. She has been a kid in care. She has had a marginalized family issues, but has come through it, right? we all have issues with our families and stuff, right? And challenges with our family. But and when we have those issues, we need support. We go looking for support. We should get that support so our families don't break up, right? And I think she gets it. She understands that. And that's what I like about her. So yeah, I think I got involved provincially after Nick passed away because of talking to people like Grand Chief Stuart Phillip, who's very active. It's things like Site C and stuff like that. Doug Kelly, the First Nations Health Authority, did a lot of educating for me on how the system works and where the failings are. And I'm going to get even more active in the next 4 years. I considered actually running this election. The problem was is I just got married and I'm going away. So I'm going to be gone for almost the good portion of the election cycle, right? The actual, once the writs dropped, I'll be gone for 3 weeks. So I'm not back till April 26th. So I would only be here for 7 or 9 days or whatever before the election. But I'm still staying active. I am contributing to the NDP financially and doing what I can through other venues to try and get rid of this government. Because I just think this government has let us down huge. And it's cost me my son, in my opinion, you know. I actually feel their actions were criminal in their case. I know their mom, Nick's mom, says that. I haven't said it overtly too often, but I will stand by that when you have a court imposed condition for an intensive support and supervision person, which is called an ISP worker, to be assigned to you, which Nick had, and the provincial government, as a cost-saving measure, pulled all those workers out of the communities and made them report to Burnaby Youth Detention on Willingdon, and so he never got that support. To me, you violated a court-imposed condition. So therefore, your actions are criminal. They're criminally negligent. You breached a condition. Your own court imposed a condition that you intentionally did not fulfill. And that might have made all the difference in the world with Nick. He saw his probation officer twice in 60 days, not including the day they came and took him from my house. So.
You were mentioning there were some other missed opportunities, in your opinion, too, throughout the process. That obviously being...
Yeah, that was one. What were some of the other ones that I mentioned?
One of the other ones you had mentioned earlier was just being kicked out of the treatment camp for smoking.
Yes, so right.
Like picking your battles.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So the earlier in his probation, I took it upon myself to call Creekside Detox in Surrey and get him in there. I explained what was going on. I explained that he had a couple charges pending, that he was ready, willing, and able to get treatment, that he wanted help. And they said, okay, bring him. And I went with him to Creekside. He was had an intake interview, which I didn't even sit in on. He did it privately, and I left him there. I said goodbye, and I said, I'll see you in 4 or 5 days, and you can call me. And then I got a phone call that night at 12:30 at night from a nurse saying, you need to come get your son. He's been kicked out of the program. And I said, why? And she said, he went outside to have a cigarette. And I was like, he's in an addictions program for meth. You're kicking him out for smoking a cigarette? I think there's more important battles to fight here. I can't understand how, again, another provincial agency, Fraser Health, you know, has an addictions facility that kicks someone out for having an addiction. That makes no sense. And the rules are getting in the way of actually helping people. So that was a huge missed opportunity for Nick. I left there, I remember, and went and saw a nurse friend of mine and just did some brainstorming with her on what can we do next. There's just nothing out there. You know, other than the medical detox, which is better than nothing, there's no treatment programs out there. There's no mental health programs for youth out there that they can just, you know, register for and go to. There's just nothing there because there's been so many cuts. So yeah, there was tons of missed opportunities with Nick that I thought in that short time, you know. Another one was us being able to take him to the program. that was a missed opportunity. That would have saved the government money and then eased his anxiety. And they decided, nope, I'm taking him. The probation officer's like, no, I'm taking him. I'm just putting him on a plane at YVR. And of course, he'd relapsed just before, so he was detoxing. And luckily, I'd had contact with the people in the program by then, so I knew their email addresses, so I kind of gave him a heads up that he was detoxing. But like I said earlier, they didn't know anything about his self-harm or suicide threat history.
She believed it was about 75 youth detox beds were slashed, even though there was a promise in 2013 of a 500 bed increase, and you never,
Yeah, the government just says stuff like that just to make a news headline and stuff. They had no intentions of ever having any beds, and there weren't any when Nick needed them in January of 2015. So I've never seen any evidence of youth detox beds. I know that I remember after Nick dying that there was an announcement at Lionsgate Hospital about a wealthy benefactor donating money to build some youth either mental health or detox beds. I'm not sure. Often they're both, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of times these cases are both. They're both mental health and detox or and substance abuse. In Nick's case, I believe there was anxiety issues, huge anxiety issues. Those are things I suffered from as a kid, but I'm only starting to kind of get a grasp on now. And I think had he had a mental health assessment or access to a mental health assessment and access to substance abuse treatment, we would not be talking about his case right now, right? So yeah, to say, oh, there's going to be 75 new beds or however many new beds over the course of 4 years to me means nothing until they're actually there. Until we actually start taking this issue seriously and a whole change in thinking has to happen.
All the numbers, right?
Yeah.
BC Liberals keep accusing the NDP of being too political when speaking about families. Speaking about families, go to the media with their family member story.
Yeah, I mean, like I've never felt that. Like I actually mentioned before about Melanie Mark and stuff. I've never felt like they've used Nick's case, just for political reasons. They care.
Yeah.
You know, somebody I always had respect for. I told your cousin this. Somebody I've always had respect for is Leonard Krog. Is it Krog or Krog? Krog, I think. And I just had a lot of respect for him as a person, even though I never voted NDP in the past. I lived in Nanaimo, right? So I went to university there. And I was poor. I lived in social housing. Nick and Kirk were really small. And I was applying to the RCMP and corrections. And the RCMP called me up one day and said, yeah, we would like to process your application, but there's a problem because you failed to pay a student loan of $600 and it's on your credit rating. I knew instantly it was a mistake because I'd never had a student loan for $600. I always had $4,000, whatever, right? And anyway, I went to, I couldn't get it fixed. They wouldn't take it off my thing. CIBC kept blaming Equifax. Equifax kept blaming CIBC, and I was just this poor, dumb guy who was getting the shaft, basically, and it was stopping me from getting a good career. And so somebody told me to go see my MLA, so I went and saw Leonard, but I saw him at his lawyer's office, and it was his wife that came and helped me, and she said, and I told her, I said, I have no money, like I'm on welfare, so, and she goes, I don't worry about it, she goes, I will take care of it. So she wrote this letter and sent it off to the CIBC, and it said, if you don't take this off, we're going to sue you, right, because you're costing him a career, and he has babies to feed. And it was within a few weeks, it was gone. But in the meantime, I got hired in corrections, so I just decided not to pursue RCMP after that. So I'll never forget that. I'll never forget how kind his wife was. So I really believe that they don't use these for political purposes. They're telling the stories because the stories need to be told. And all the other stories need to be told too. All right? So I don't feel I'm being used at all, and if I ever did, I would just stop.
Yeah.
I'd just stop talking, that's all.
And she just basically says, what do you want in a government?
Well, I want a government that's ethical and honest and has integrity. there's a real lack of values and ethics in all levels of politics right now. I'm even seeing it at the federal level. And I'm disappointed, actually, with our federal government right now, too, for a number of reasons. But I just want to see a government in BC that's just ethical and honest and without an arrogant leader. I feel like John is a genuine person. He didn't realize this, but I was in Harbor Air one day, and he was flying to Victoria. I was flying to Victoria as well for work. And he wasn't even the leader of the party at the time. It was before the last election. He was just an MLA. And people started interacting with him. And I remember thinking at the time, actually, he seems like a really genuine guy. Like, he just enjoys having these conversations about politics and was very personable and that kind of thing. And it always stuck in my head. So when he became the leader, I actually thought, you know what? He's going to be a good leader. He'll be a good leader for that party. So I feel like he's ethical, honest, and humble. That's the biggest thing. I don't find the leaders of the other parties very humble. You know, Christy Clark, I don't think I even have to say. She's not humble at all. I feel like, you know, her whole history from university on has been checkered with poor ethics and arrogance. And then Andrew Weaver, I don't find very humble either. He, especially around the IPPs, those independent power projects. I know it has nothing to do with Nick's case, but since I've got involved in provincial politics, one of the things that I've seen is these independent power producers that produce power for BC Hydro, and we pay them three times the amount of money to produce the energy that we charge people. So we're losing money every time we buy power off them. But even more importantly than that, they're bad deals. They're bad financial deals for us. But more importantly than that, back when Gordon Campbell was the premier, Andrew Weaver supported these projects and promoted them through robocalls during the election, saying they were green. And they're not green. He promoted them as water wheels. They're just water wheels in the river, run of the river, mom and pop operations that produce energy, and it's green energy. So forget the fact that it's financially stupid, it's also environmentally disastrous. Because if you go look at a number of rivers, but the one that pops up all the time in my research is Ashloo River up towards Squamish somewhere there. And if you go look at it, I've seen aerial photos of it from before and after. It's not a mom and pop operation water wheel. They've destroyed that river and salmon have died. That's not green. And he won't ever admit that he was wrong on that. He just says, well, I proposed limits. Well, no, you didn't. You didn't say anything about limits at the time. You're only saying it now because you realize how stupid it was. But he won't actually say I was wrong. And to me, that shows arrogance. I think a leader can admit when they're wrong and can say, you know what, I made a mistake on that one and we're going to fix it. I don't ever see that with Andrew. I don't see it with Christy. But I think John is the type of guy that would... I think I even tweeted it out once that, you know, he'd be the type of guy I'd sit down and have a beer with. I don't think I'd want to have a beer with the other two. So, yeah. So that's why I'm going to be supporting the NDP. And if they get into power, it doesn't mean I would not hold them accountable either. If they were to...
government.
Exactly.
Anybody in a place of power should be held accountable.
I agree. And we're the ones who put them there, and we'll take them out if they don't do what we want them to do. So...